forward to hearing your, some of the work that you have been doing under other research grants, while also applied by answers, about the history of the Aboriginal land use of Wagait. And I know this work has been very important in generating some of your new thinking. And so we're really looking forward to hearing that. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Ruth. Well, thank you all for coming. Yo, Pende Pende. Nene Ngango. Larrakia and Al. Wada Thunru. Pende Pende Go. I'm just acknowledging the ancestors of this country and the people, and I'd like to acknowledge the Aboriginal people in the room and all other guests. Thank you for coming today. I don't know if you know anything about the Delissaville Wagait Larrakia Aboriginal Land Trust, but it's just southwest of Darwin, behind Litchfield Park, near Labelle Station, between Labelle and Finnis River Station, on the Finnis River, and down towards the west coast is Baldal community, and then there's Pundale community where all my family are. Now I'm pushing this button, is that correct? Mm-hmm. Oh yes, there you go. Here's the book. I might just pass that around. Now, there's a lot of political controversy around the Wagait and over ownership, and so it's quite a contentious issue. And I'm not going to go into the details of that, because what I'm more interested in is the Indigenous land use of the area, and that's what my focus is on for this project, because the NLC have got all the records of what's happened with the dispute of that area. So here we've got, this is my abstract, and that's, it's an important way of drawing the historical data to provide a comprehensive history of ways in which Aboriginal people sought to formalise their association for the use of the land. And Aboriginal people have a long history of use of the Delissaville Wagait Larrakia Aboriginal Land Trust prior to colonisation and afterwards as well. And at the moment, what we've done is I've been able to compile the land use since 1976 and what's happened in that process. And the book Country of the Heart is part of that process of that history, documenting the history. And there are other documents associated with this as well. The project focused on the White Eagle Aboriginal Corporation in 1985 and subsequent establishment of Twin Hill Aboriginal Corporation in 1997 and the management of Twin Hill Station, cattle adjustment business in the NT's pastoral industry sector. Got directors and members and TOs, Rak Mak Mak Marranunggu governance and leadership. And that's been 20 years in the making next year, which is quite a milestone, significant milestone for Indigenous business in the Northern Territory, and in fact probably Australia. I haven't checked that part as yet. Of particular interest is the way in which Aboriginal people negotiated with the organisation and externally with government and non-government organisations. And we've had a number of partnerships with the Northern Land Council in undertaking a massive land management program for Mimosa Pigra and the Indigenous Land Corporation as well, and Department of Primary Industries and Fisheries. So it's been ongoing since 1997. And now I think the Territory Natural Resource Management have taken over some of that responsibility in terms of running grants within to manage MRSA. The purpose of the study, the research project will be conducted by myself and as a senior research fellow here at Charles Darwin University. And the aim is to develop an Aboriginal business story for the history of Aboriginal land use, the Delissaville Wagait Larrakia Aboriginal Land Trust. And often people just call it the Wagait. The benefits of the study is that my investigation into the historical documents will provide the fundamental knowledge that is grounded on local Aboriginal knowledge and practices. And the archival research materials will establish links from the Aboriginal people's past history of the land use of the Wagait and to what currently is occurring in 2016. And it's an important phase for Twin Hill because now we've it's unique in that we got a 20-year land use agreement way back then, and that don't occur anymore. So we're up for renewal or application of the new agreement. That's next year. So the ethics approval. Dr. Ford's investigation commenced after seeking CDU her ethics approval, which was approved in June. And ethics is quite an interesting process. So they granted the grant in February, but it took a long time to get the ethics right. It's a bit of a minefield going through the ethics process. Sometimes you can get it right the first time, and other times it takes a bit of tweaking. For those of you that are interested in going down that pathway, archival research to date. I've been to Melbourne at the Victorian Museum, found lots of interesting artefacts there from the 1800s. From the Wagait region, and just absolutely blew me away because a lot of the artefacts are exact. My mum had made exact replicas, style of throwing spears and the spears themselves, and the kenbi and the nunga nungas. Just amazing. And then I looked at other artefacts in the room from the Daly River region, they were very different to the style that my mum had taught to me and passed on to me, which I'll be passing on to my daughter, Emily. So interesting, just going down there. When I was down there in April, May, Emily came with me as my research assistant. So she was learning about her history as well and what that means for her. So that ongoing intergenerational learning and learning how to research is a really important part of the journey for Marunungu women, it seems. Because my mum travelled with me when I was doing my PhD, and if she could write a PhD, she would have done it herself. But she used me as her voice to making sure that what was in my PhD was basically reflecting what she was wanting to happen about recording our knowledge. So anyway, however, the fundamental knowledge prior to settler societies that is grounded on local Aboriginal knowledge and practice is difficult to obtain from a documented written text base. So I've engaged Aboriginal communities through Aboriginal protocols, ceremonies, songs, performance and rituals of the past, present and future to learn further about the significance and importance of the country. And in that, the ongoing ceremonies are really important in the way that the body paint reflects a lot of the signatures for different clan-based areas, and the songs and ceremonies are all, that's one way of saying, they're like signatures as well to ownership of country. A lot of work done by Pavanelli, Barwick and Linda Barwick, Alan Marrett, Reuben Brown, Sally Trumbull and other ethnomusicologists are starting to really get into that and document exactly the importance of what songs and performance are for Aboriginal ownership. And if you want to read further on that, they're the people to look up. It's really very fascinating. And quite important for this part of my, this component of the work that I'll be writing about. I have commenced several interviews with Aboriginal and non-Aboriginal people in the archives to learn more about where the documents have come from and ended up in the system in the archives. And the stories behind some of the photos from private collections and where early anthropologists have swapped information, and it's really, really fascinating. It's like some of the early naturalists that came up to the territory to do exploration in the 1800s, they gathered a lot of information from up here and took it back to South Australia and Melbourne. And in Melbourne, a lot of naturalist societies banded together and formed these the societies in the 1800s and exchanged a lot of the artefacts amongst each other. And a lot of that has now ended up in the Victorian Museum. And that was just by pure fluke that Michael Christie had put me in touch with the archivist down there to say, hey, Linda's down there, she would like to go and look at some of this information, if you've got any. And she had been doing some research up here, but out in the West Arnhem region. And she had gathered, she'd found some of this information from the Daly Wagait region and was able to access that quite easily and bring it out for me to have a look at. And that was great timing, I must say. Next month, in December, I'm going down to the IATSIS because they have lots and lots of information down there. It's amazing. And any of you that are doing research with Indigenous people, you have to get to IATSIS. I've gone through reams and reams of papers, and Emily and I spent a whole week down there photocopying madly, and lots of documents. But they've got a lot of restricted information there, which now we're going through a process, an indemnity form I filled out yesterday to send down with a list of things that I've requested. And some of those things, because I'm an Aboriginal female, I'm not allowed to look at all. And I've asked that Aboriginal male member of staff, if they could have a look through some of those documents to see if that might be, have any relevance to what I'm looking for in the not text-based information. So there's lots of old recordings from the 50s, out of Bellewin, but there's, and that's from a wax-based cylinder. And it really is amazing how the sound recordings are made up. You've got to, if you ever get an opportunity, you've got to have a listen to those. Sound like it's a bit like that, but when they slow it down, you can hear what has been said. It is amazing. So the plan will be to carry on further interviews over the next few months with key stakeholders and to obtain where authorised the use of records and photos from private collections. So I know of lots of people that had property around that area and they've got a lot of photos, so now it's a matter of finding where they all are and asking permission if you can find some of their photos. So like the towns in Spring, for instance, and the rehorses were back in the 60s and 70s. So the history, the Northern Territory history, the elements of the history are available in earlier publications such as Country But Heart, and this project will draw together important historical data and comprehensive history of the ways in which Aboriginal people formalise their associations for the use of land through customary law and Western law. But it's really interesting reading through the Wagait dispute document and having access to that. I did go to the NLC to ask them if I could access their records, and their libraries are all boxed up because they're relocating the library. So I can't access that information for the next 12 months, and by that time this project will be over. But I contacted a friend of mine to see if they had a copy of that electronic, and they go, thank God for that. But anyway, there's stuff in there that I'm sure I read that report back in 95 or whenever it was, but and I've read it again just recently. I'm going, oh my God, jeez, how do we live through that? Just the horrendousness for Aboriginal people to go through that process. And when you think about land claims, you know, prior to land claims we were all quite happy and friendly, and after land claim, the Land Rights Act, it turned very ugly. Yes. So the Twin Hill Aboriginal Corporation research project is unique in the recordings of the Northern Territory history as it is leading Indigenous pastoral property that has been in operation as an Indigenous owned and operated pastoral business. And the success this Indigenous business has had is unique in such an environment in Australia that needs documenting for future generations, especially as this is one of the only Indigenous businesses that contribute to the Australian beef export to Indonesia. And there's a couple of, recently I went to an Indigenous cattleman's workshop down at Tennant Creek and found that met lots of other Indigenous pastoral property owners, and a lot of them are selling beef also to Indonesia, which is great. But at the time I wrote this application, I was unaware of that. I just assumed that people were selling their beef interstate and to the local market. So another ARC. If this green application is successful in its anticipated, the project will be further developed with the submission of an ARC Discovery Indigenous Grant on Indigenous economic sustainable governance and leadership in the Indigenous pastoral sector in 2017. So that's it. Thank you.